I'm 58 years old. When I was 14 years old, I started refereeing. So you can do the math, but that's 1974. And when I started, me and my four friends who went and took the course, we were the youngest. We were really the only teenage referees in Northern Virginia. Now this is old time Northern Virginia soccer. And I'm still doing games. And I learned some things when I was 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, that things to do that helped me not only survive refereeing, but actually enjoy it. And so I'm gonna tell you a little bit about that story. I'm gonna give you three really big ideas of what you can do today to increase your enjoyment of the game, of the refereeing side of the game. If you have not refereed a game in the middle, I'm gonna give you that one big tip that will make you fully confident to go out and referee your first game in the middle. And then if we have some time, we'll talk about, and I know you've talked about it last week or so, last time, about management of whiny parents and coaches and players and things like that. But first, let me ask you this question. Oh, by the way, so I noticed this shirt. Who has this? How many of you guys have this? You refereed in the WAGS tournament, right? Well, this is the Real Vodka tournament. And so I started refereeing when she was a mom and she was a coach, and I knew her before she passed away at a very early age. And so I was refereeing before WAGS tournament and the Virginian really started. So that's how old I am. So who here brought something besides an iPad or an iPhone to take notes with? Look, when I ask a question, you raise your hand, because it is awesome to be smart, okay? So raise your hand. What's your name?
Zach.
All right, Zach, two things. I need you to take notes, because sometimes I get carried away and I lose track and I'll say, Zach, remind me, we're gonna go back and we're gonna talk about this. So will you do that for me, Zach? Yes, sir, Mr. Glass, yes? Yes, sir, okay, and Zach, for volunteering, I'm gonna give you a copy of the absolute best book ever written for referees, all right? You can't even get this book in America, all right? I got it for you, I've got a couple others, all right? So now you've seen what just happened to Zach because he raised his hand and volunteered something, and I'll talk about that book a little bit later, tell you why it's so important, all right? So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna acknowledge that what we do is actually pretty cool. It's actually pretty hard, but what you do as young kiddos, right, refereeing and going and making game critical decisions and getting yelled at by wacky adults is actually an awesome thing to be doing. I'm gonna tell you a little bit more about my backstory. We're gonna talk about the three big things you could do to really enjoy the game. Make a lot of money, let's enjoy the game too. And then we'll do the descent stuff and the managing people. So how many found, let me ask you this. So who's in the room? So raise your hand if you've actually gone out and have been an AR or a referee in the middle. So presumably most everybody's hand will go up. You can raise it really high, okay? Right, you saw what happened to Zach when he raised his hand. It's awesome, okay? All right, now if you've been doing that for more than a year, so it's the spring of 2016, you've been doing it for more than a year. If you've been doing it for more than 2 years, keep your hands up. This is for the kids, okay? This is, if you've been doing it for more than 4 years, awesome. All right, how many of you found, as you move from player and class to field, that it was harder than it looked, right? Let's be honest, harder than it, and the rest of you guys, it was easy when I started, right? No problem, awesome. And I'll tell you a story. So a couple of years ago, I've got 9 kids. That's the other reason they invite me here, because I can tell cool stories about having 9 kids. I've got 5 teenagers still at home, all right, 4 launch into the world. But a couple of years ago, one of my sons is playing a Little League baseball. Now, I'm not a baseball guy. I played Little League, but I didn't play at any level higher than that. I know nothing about umpiring, except for what I see umpires do and what I hear coaches and spectators say about umpires. And if you think about it, that's pretty much the level of help you're getting from the sidelines, right? Coaches and parents who know nothing except for what they see referees doing and what they hear other adults saying. So, I'm sitting in the stands, I'm watching, sometimes I'm keeping score, so I'm in the dugout, and I'm thinking to myself, how hard could it be to be a Little League Baseball umpire? Soccer game, I'm running 2, 4, 5, 6 miles a game. Little League Baseball umpire, you just sit there and the ball comes to you. So one game, there's no umpire. I say, how hard can this be? I'll be the umpire. Cool. They give me the mask thing, the chest protector thing that I'm using like a shield. This is easy, right? Because I'm getting all the calls right from the stands. Put the mask on, chest protector thing on. I get down behind the plate and I start thinking now. So now I'm thinking, oh, that ball is hard. That 11-year-old who's pitching it looks bigger than 11. This kid who's standing in front of me to catch it and protect me, he's an amateur. Game starts, right? The balls start to come in. Now in baseball, anybody umpired baseball, sat behind a plate? One, okay. So in baseball, you what?
I was a pitcher.
You're a pitcher, you're the dangerous guy throwing a hard ball at the umpire, all right? So you do what? Are you an awesome catcher? You protect the umpire, right? That's your job. Did you know that's your main job? Is to protect the umpire. It really is. So all you gotta do is catch the ball. All right, and plus you've got a kid in the batter's box with an aluminum bat. It's awesome, all right? So I'm sitting there, and in baseball, every pitch that comes in, if the batter doesn't swing, the umpire has to make a decision and tell the world about it. Right? It's a ball or it's a strike. It's not like soccer. Like in soccer, we're out there sometimes. Like I've seen Eric referee, and he'll look at some, and he's not really sure if he saw it right. He goes, play on, right? That's what we all do. That. We go, play on. Oh, I didn't, nothing there. You can't do that in baseball, right? You have to make a decision, and you have to tell the world what your decision is. So how hard can this be? So I'm sitting there, ball's coming in, and when you have no experience being an umpire, and when you were beginning to be a soccer referee, your brain and your eyes just aren't trained. So balls are coming in, and I'm thinking, oh my God. And I'm realizing I have about a half a second or maybe a full second to make a decision about whether the ball is too high or too low or outside the plate, which always looked really easy from the stands, all right? And I'm doing it, and I know the balls are coming in, And before my brain kicks in gear, I'm going, strike. And then like a half second later, your brain kicks in and goes, no, it wasn't. It wasn't a strike, it was way up high. But they're tolerating me, right? And I'm doing the best I can. But after a couple innings, I hear it from the dugout. Jeez, where was that ball? That was too long. And I know I'm getting about 50-50. I'm hitting about 50-50 correct, right? So between one of the innings, I go over to the coach and I say to him, hey, I just gotta let you know that this is the very first time in my life that I've ever sat behind a plate and tried to umpire. And you know what? It looked a heck of a lot easier when I was up there in the stands or there in the dugout. Give me some grace, I'm doing the best I can. And they were fine with that, all right? So the lesson is that, yeah, sure, as you go from player and student of refereeing to getting on a field, that is going to be a new experience, and there is a learning curve. And the second lesson there is that, you know what? It's okay to say to somebody, I'm a beginner. You really particularly ought to be going out when you're an AR and you're showing up and the referee is doing a pregame. Tell them. I always ask my young ARs, how long you been doing this? Same question I was asking you guys as they came in. All right? It's okay to say, hey, this is my first year. So give me some help and give me some grace. And it's okay. The second thing I want to say about this is what you're doing is awesome. You're putting yourself out there to be criticized. Look at all the people who aren't in this room, right? Most of your friends would not do this. They would never go out to be yelled at by someone who's not their mom or dad or their coach or their teacher. And really what you're doing, in my view, is you're embarking on that first rung of the American dream. And the American dream is this, that if I have a gift or a talent or an interest and I get good at it, I can put that into the marketplace and I can get paid for it, all right? And if I'm good at it and I enjoy it and I get paid for it, that's like awesome. That's what people want to do, all right? So I'll tell you my story a little bit. Is I grew up right down the road in Annandale, and I played for the Annandale Boys Club, now the Annandale Boys and Girls Club. And I was very lucky because this is the 70s, it starts the late 60s and the early 70s, and this is the heyday of the growth of soccer in Northern Virginia. And when I'm 12 years old, I get on my first, what now we call them a travel team, and I'm there with awesome players. Guys who are a lot better than I was, but it was really, really, really fun. And Annandale was really the leader back in the 70s of teams, youth teams in Northern Virginia. I went to TJ, right? And how many anybody here go to TJ? No? That's awesome, okay. So TJ has changed over the years. You might know, you can go check it out on Wikipedia. Today, you have to be really good at science and math. When I went there, you had to be good at everything, right? And I played soccer at the parents, they laugh at that. I played soccer at TJ, and then I went and played soccer on scholarship at William Mary, again with a bunch of players that I grew up playing with. And in 1976, when I was 18, we had a team of 18 and 19-year-olds, and we were a McGuire Cup champion. So that was the U19 champions of the whole country, that tournament. And so that was my soccer journey. And I was very, very lucky to be here in Annandale and to be playing with good guys and to have, and this is all, there's no paid coaches, there's no trainers, there's no specialists, there's no turf fields. I mean, it's all rocks. And we look at the pictures now, it's like we're playing on Mars. And this was really the beginning of soccer, and Annandale was a real powerhouse. And then Braddock Road developed great teams, and that's what brings us all here today. From a refereeing standpoint, when I was 14, one of the coaches that I was playing for said, "Hey, you guys should go and you should become referees. You can go and you can make some money, and you know, I think you'd be interested in it." So back then, the five of us went over to Maryland, because they didn't have this stuff, right? They didn't have teenagers who wanted to be referees. It was mainly, the refereeing was dominated mainly by foreign-born folks who had come to the United States to play soccer or to coach or do whatever. And so went over to Maryland and back and for several days, several different nights, took the course. And back then, what happened is the end of the course, you took the test, you passed the test, and they had two tables. So you had one table is full of equipment. You could take whatever you wanted. We just wrote down what we took, because it would come out of our pay at the end of the season. And the other table had these big sheets of paper. And there was a fellow by the name of Nelson Coburn, who really was the godfather of refereeing here in Northern Virginia, who had all of the games. Now, it wasn't like today, where there's 8 billion games, you know, every weekend. But I had all the games, and you just signed up. So you took the test, and you were allowed to referee. And there were no ARs, okay? This is pre- three games on every U11 game, or three referees on every U11 game. This is, you got a whistle, you got an assignment, you went out and you did games by yourself with very little training. Now the good news was that the parents were by and large not as sophisticated as they are now. So you just went out and did it. When I went down to William & Mary, I played there 4 years on scholarship, but I also continued my refereeing. So I never had to have a traditional job. I made a ton of money in high school for youth. We'll talk about that. When I went to William & Mary, I refereed all over the peninsula down there. Did a high school, private high school, public high school. I refereed in leagues where we wore the black and white striped shirts like they were in ice hockey. I ran classes like this for guys and gals who were a lot older than me, who were being introduced to soccer and wanted to referee. And I ran the referee program at Tidewater Soccer Club, which meant that I assigned. Now this is pre-internet. We don't have cell phones. It's like seeing your buddy on the campus and saying, "Can you do the three games on field number 3 out here on Saturday?" "Yes, I can." And writing it down and keeping track of that. So again, I'm making all my spending money in college refereeing. Side bonus was, because I had a job, I was allowed to have a car as a freshman. And so that was cool, because my wife thought that my now wife, when she was my girlfriend, thought that was pretty cool that as a freshman I had a car. So a lot of cool benefits benefits can come from refereeing. So let me ask this now. Who here has had a nightmare? And I don't mean that you went to bed, you had a bad dream, and you woke up and it was over. I'm talking about you're doing a game, everything is going miserably, you wish it was a dream that you could wake up from, you wish that the earth would just open up and you could just disappear. Has that happened to anybody yet? Your first name is again?
Jocelyn.
Jocelyn, right. Anybody else? Your name is?
Andrew.
So can you come up, Jocelyn? Come on, this is participatory. They want to participate. Andrew, come up here, and I'll get to you in a sec.
I already had to go up.
Are you comfortable turning around and sharing your game nightmare? Your dad's gone. Hey, maybe he was the referee. Come here, Andrew. Andrew, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Can you share what happened?
Okay, so I was given some U19 boys travel matches, and I was the AR, luckily. And it was freezing cold. It was so cold that I was literally in pain. And I had just terrible parents. I was...
Not that guy who just left.
No.
You mean the parents at the game, right?
Yeah. Behind me. And I was like, I could feel myself messing up some calls, like some offside calls. And I was like, oh my God. And I hear behind me this lady, I mess up a offside call, and she goes, chicken shit. And I was like, what? And I turned around, and I looked right at her, and she starts laughing. And then I turn back around, and I'm standing there on the line like, oh, I want this to end so badly. Yeah, that's my nightmare.
How did that make you feel? She's awesome. She just told a great story. Sorry you missed it. How did that make you feel?
Terrible.
All right. Is there anything now in retrospect that you think about what you were doing on that day that could have made a difference to maybe her reaction or how you felt about that?
I mean, I probably should have said something to her or to my sister who is the center ref, but...
Did this woman persist?
No. She like laughed and then there was like 10 minutes left in the game and didn't say anything.
Okay. All right. Stay right here. Andrew, tell us, are you comfortable talking, telling us about your nightmare? All right, tell us about it.
Well, it was actually the night after I got certified, and...
You got certified on one day, and the next night you got a game.
Yes.
Awesome. Good for you.
I just happened to be refereeing the final of the World Cup.
Okay.
The finals. I was centering.
Oh, this is a real nightmare.
Yes.
This is you went to sleep.
Yes.
Okay, have you had a nightmare where you're actually refereeing a game?
Oh, no.
That's the one. Okay, all right. I'll hear about that one later. Did you have a nightmare? All right, come up here. And actually, Andrew, so have you done centers yet?
No.
Do you want to do centers?
Yes.
All right, so remind me, Andrew, just write him. Andrew, centers. Okay. What's your name?
Thomas.
All right. So we're talking about games where you wish you could wake up and it would all be over.
Mm-hmm.
Are you comfortable?
Yeah.
Telling? All right.
I was.
You want to take your hands out of your pockets?
Yeah.
It's awesome. Okay.
It was my first game. I was ARing an SFL U16 boys game, and so I got to the field, and we got on. We got our pregame out. We go out to do it. And the first throw-in comes, and the ref looks at me, and I couldn't remember which way to...
Okay.
Which direction was which. So I'm just like, it's going that way. And, like, it's for white, and he's like... So he just kept...
The referee? Yeah? Okay.
Which way I had to throw my flag. And then there was a lot of calls where I'm like, offsides. He's like, no, it's not. You're not calling it right at all.
Okay, that's interesting.
Well, he was just like, mm-mm. And then later he pulls me aside and he's like, I was just trying to tell you not that you're nervous and just forget about being nervous. But every time he's like, nope. And he's just like, you're good. Just put your flag down for a minute.
What did you think? Do you think you were working hard and getting in the right position and getting it right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? So it was the referee that caused your nightmare?
A little bit. I was nervous, but then every time he's like, it's not offsides or it's off that other player.
Okay.
It's like, oh, I'm not really doing as well as I thought.
Okay. All right. And your name again was?
Thomas.
Thomas. All right. For sharing your story, I got something cool for you and for you, right? And again, we'll come back and we'll talk about why this book is so valuable. So there's Grandpa's book. Now for you, you have to, no. You have to read it first and then you can let him read it. Okay? It's an awesome book.
You're never going to get this.
Thank you for sharing that. Okay. So cool. Thank you very much, Thomas. All right. So there's a lot of people that didn't raise their hands and that just means you haven't refereed long enough. Every referee I know has at one time or another had a game that for some reason everything goes bad. You really wish you could wake up and it would be over, or the ground would come up and swallow you. So understand that that's probably coming and it's happened to everybody, right? So let's talk, and thank you guys for standing up in front of the crowd and sharing your nightmare, and your nightmare too, buddy, Andrew. And remember, Andrew, in the middle game, in a minute. All right, so let's talk, and I had those too. So I am 18 years old, so I've been refereeing. I must have been, maybe I was like 16, 17, all right? So I got my license, my badge at 14. By the way, when I passed my test, they gave me these. And these are I've had these for 40 years, and I've used them in every single game that I had. Mr. Coburn gave me these cards. Probably didn't even have to pay for them. So I'm about 17. I'm out doing my first sort of tournament. And again, this is back in the day. You went out, you did three games. You didn't have ARs, right? We were lucky if we could find a place that sold flags. Right? Because we didn't have stores on every corner, we didn't have Amazon, we didn't have Springfield Soccer Supply, OSI, anything like that. Right? You go out and you do games. I'm on my third game of a three-game set. It's like about U14, U15 somethings. I am at George Washington Middle School in Alexandria. They have a little stadium, a fence, and stands. And I can and now it's 40 years later and I can tell this story and I can smell the way the weather was that day. I can remember what everybody looked like, and when I talk about it, I can feel how I felt because it was so bad. First foul of the game, and it's one of the teams is from out of state, and this was always, I mean, it's typical now we have a lot of out of state teams. It was always a pain in the butt. I had a hard time doing like New Jersey teams. I don't know about you, but I always had a hard time. They had a hard time with me. First foul of the game, and the player on the team that committed the foul runs up to the ball and stands. This is like, it's midfield. He runs up the ball to stand there, right? He's been coached to do this. By the way, in my view, and I'll give you my opinion on things, so I'm gonna give you some ideas. The object now, once he has run up to deliberately delay the game, is to make sure this doesn't happen the rest of the game, okay? The object is not to spend the rest of the game marking off 10 yards and seeing if everybody's ready and blowing the whistle. So I do my thing, which is blow the whistle, no! Real out so everybody knows, get away. And he says to me, they didn't ask for 10 yards. I said, get away, he doesn't have to ask for 10 yards. Coach is like, did he ask for 10 yards, Johnny? Did he ask the ref? Did he ask? Shut up, all right? Second foul of the game. These are midfield. This is not penalty area, around the penalty area stuff. Second foul, different player, same team, runs up to the ball and stands there. I go, boom, boom, right? But ref, he didn't ask for 10 yards. Dude, you got to go 10 yards, all right? That's not their job to ask for 10. Coach is like, ref, he has to ask for 10 yards. He has to ask for it. I do my signals with referees, and let's just say it's a lot harder when you're 16, admittedly, to do this stuff than it is when you're older, when you're an adult, and certainly when you're 58, because I really don't care anymore about them so much. So I give them that, which means I heard you, stop it. I heard you, stop. Now this is before ask, tell, Send. What is it? Ask, tell?
Dismiss.
This is before, we don't have any training. All right, we go once a year to pick up our paychecks. We don't have things like this. Third time, foul. Third guy runs up to the ball, different guy now. Boom, boom, yellow card for him. Coach is going ballistic. And of course, what happens when you have an adult on the sideline yelling at a youth referee? What does the rest of the sideline do? They start yelling too, because you know what? Our coach, who played professionally in some place not in America, he knows the game better than redhead doofus teenager from Virginia, and our coach must be right, so now we're all going to join in. And so I'd already given him the bump, so now I give him the bump stands, right? Bump stands, and he's relentless. I mean, he's a real, real jerk, but he leaves. Now he's up in the stands and he's yapping. But my rule is if you're on the other side of the big fence, that's okay with me, and it was them. After the game, so now tournaments, I'm doing three, having lunch, doing three more someplace else. I'm walking out to the parking lot. I want to have a talk with you. I don't want to have a talk with you. I'm out of here. I would have given him my email address, but email had not been invented at that point, right? But the point I want to make here is that in order to have a high level of confidence and get enjoyment out of the game, you have to be a master of the laws of the game, okay? Experience refereeing and judging whether something's a foul or somebody's diving, that will come. But you're going to be in a far better position if the last time you looked at the book wasn't when you took the test, okay? And you have to be, I think, excellent. You have to be 100%. What happens if a player comes in at a free kick, you know, and he's less than 10 yards? Does the attacking team have to ask for 10 yards? No. But if I wasn't 100% sure of that, when this guy is yelling at me and all the fans are yelling at me, then I'm shattered. As a 16-year-old, now doubt is into my head, and I'm losing confidence and maybe wanting to go like the referee or the AR we saw, heard about today, leaves at halftime. Like, I'm going to be that guy if I'm not 100% sure that I'm right. And today, it's easy. There are so many resources. I'm going to tell you about a cool one. Resource at the end. I'm going to tell you about a cool resource at the end. But there's so many resources online, classes like this, where you can come in, and we'll stop just in a second. Yeah. You can come in and you can ask your question. You know, I'm not really sure what the law says about this. And you have to be excellent on things like, how do we restart the game after a whatever, all right? What happens if, I mean, what did we hear about? What happens if the bunch of 9-year-olds during a stoppage all run over to the coach, right, to get their drink because it's a little hot? What do we do? And you have to be 100% certain. I'll tell you one more and then we'll stop and get something to eat. So now spring forward 39 years. I'm doing the Virginian last year. Again, U14-somethings, right? I give a free kick about 7 yards out of the goal against the defense for dangerous play. So the attacking team has a free kick 7 yards out, and it's an indirect free kick. All right, so now you tell me, not you, but the kiddos, you tell me, what are you starting to think about as a referee about the laws of the game when you've awarded a free kick 7 yards from the goal in, you know, inside the penalty area, it's an indirect free kick? What are some of the things we start to think about?
Where do you put the wall?
I'm not concerned about where the wall is as a referee yet, okay? But, well, actually, that's a good answer. Flesh it out for me. Let me ask you this. What does the law say about where the defending players now have to go? And can they stand outside the goal, on the goal line?
Yes, no.
Yes, no. See, that's why we're here. They have to stand in between the goal posts and on the goal line, right? Okay? So anything else that we're thinking about as we are managing a free kick heading in, right? Yes, sir.
If they do have a lot of players on the wall and they decide to take it direct, hoping it goes off someone, you have to know if it does go off someone, and sometimes there's a lot of players rushing up all at the same time.
Right, so you have to be alert, okay? Yes, and you have to, be watched. Number one is, if they're gonna get, the required distance is, they're on the goal line between the goalposts, all right? And it has to touch, it has to be played by the kicker and touch one other player before it goes in the goal, or else it won't be a goal. And you keep your hand up until it touches that second player. So these are things that are running through your head. So now, what does every attacking team player turn and say to the referee when the referee has awarded, referee has awarded that free kick, so dangerous play, free kick, yes, they'll say, is it direct? Yes, they'll say that. But what are they? What is the next thing that comes out of their mouths?
10 yards.
Say it?
10 yards.
What will they say? What are the words they'll use?
Can I have 10 yards?
Right. And that's teams that are coached by average coaches that aren't extraordinary, they always ask that. They always ask that question. That's not how my friends won a national championship, because we didn't ask questions like that. This team says to me, kid goes, do I have to wait for your whistle? I go, you do not have to wait for my whistle. Right? Right? The law says he can go. He doesn't need to wait for my whistle. Right? I go, awesome. I'm thinking, awesome, watch this. You do not have to wait for my whistle, stand back. He taps it to his buddy, and he kicks in the goal because the other team is disorganized, not well coached, and they're thinking, at best, this referee is going to march off, and we're going to have this big ceremony free kick in about 3 minutes, and he's going to blow his whistle. Right? So ball goes in the goal. What does coach of defending team say to referee? Go ahead.
We weren't ready.
You didn't blow your whistle. And I wanted to say, you don't coach him very good. But I didn't. I said, he doesn't need to blow the whistle. But again, if I wasn't 100% sure on the law of the game, and knowing what was required of the defense and what's not required, and when they can go and take that free kick, then I would start to lose confidence in the game. So we'll stop and get something to eat here for a sec. But my advice to you is become an ever student of the laws of the game. I'm on a bunch of Facebook groups with referees, and I'm gonna show you some cool stuff later. And senior referees and assigners and pro referees. And what do we discuss? We watch video and we discuss in part, what is that we remind each other, what do the laws of the game say about this? All right? You never want to get caught messing up a law of the game. Oh, it's indirect free kick, that's a penalty. Oh, no, it's not a penalty kick. All right? All right, so let's take a few minutes, Amy.
Hold on.
Talking if that's okay. So, Mr. Highsmith, we had a question from one of yours about the new laws of the game and that aren't even effective yet. And I suspect that the answer is some version of, don't worry about it until we teach it to you and tell you that the laws have actually changed. Would I be right?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. That's the best I can tell you right now. William had some complicated question about impeding. I don't even know. All right, so is that first point helpful to you? That the more that you are an expert in what the laws of the game say, the more you will be able to keep your confidence when those people who only know stuff because they've watched referees and heard adults yell at referee yell at you, the stronger you will feel on the inside. All right? That's a good rule for life, actually. All right? And I guarantee you that will help make the act of refereeing more enjoyable for you. All right, so now, second point I would make is this. And again, I learned this for whatever reason, I learned this early on and it really helped me. And that is to bring a professional attitude to your craft of refereeing. All right, let me talk to you about what that means. You guys are all getting games, right? And you have a, so I don't know how far out you're scheduling, but you've got a game scheduled maybe for next weekend. And there's really two ways to approach this. The way that average people approach going out to referee a game is, I've got a game and I'm just gonna show up and I hope it all goes well and I'm gonna get out of there as fast as I can and go to my notebook and tote up how much money I made and on to the next thing. That's not a real good way to develop confidence when people are yelling at you. So bringing a professional attitude to the game for young folks goes something like this. Number one, I'm checking about midweek to make sure I actually remember where my game is on Saturday or Sunday and what time it is. If I don't have a driver's license and I'm not driving myself, I'm making sure that mom and dad or whoever's gonna drive me are also keyed into, oh, I have a game Saturday at such and such a field. And by the way, a referee with a professional attitude shows up at that field for any game he or she is assigned at least 30 minutes before the game. My rule is I like to show up 45 minutes before the game. That's me. I like to actually do a warm-up. I like to absorb the atmosphere. And it doesn't matter. I've done U11 House League games, right? I'm the first one at the field. I'm showing up 45 minutes before the game just because I want to be comfortable there. Next thing is, you're starting to think as a young referee, is my uniform ready? Because you cannot be at 8:30 Saturday morning and you have a 9 o'clock game, so it's already late, and you're saying to mom, did you wash my shirt? Where is it? I can't find my sock, all right? So how about Thursday or Friday? Has that ever happened, like any place? And guess what? Every adult I know will be happy to show you how to wash your clothes. But think about this now. You're going out to do a game, and you're stressing at 8:30 because I can't find my yellow shirt, so now I got to wear my green shirt, and I'm going to be the only one. Or I can't find my socks. So you think, well, this stuff is sort of silly, Ben. Why are you telling us this? Because this is how professional referees think, right? Next thing, or we talked about getting there early, right? It's easy today to wear the right uniform. And frankly, all the youngins I see that come out to games to referee with me or to be AR or that I see at my kids' games, you guys are wearing the right uniform. Back in the day, I had to like special order stuff from England or from New York or got it from Mr. Coburn over in Maryland, all right? So there's no excuse for showing up in anything other than the proper shirt, black shorts, the proper socks, and some good shoes, all right? The biggest violators of this rule, I have found, are senior referees who are out there wearing shirts that were, like, over 5 years ago, that was the style. And they might be a good referee, but if I'm out there and they show up in a shirt that's over 5 years ago, my first impression of them is down a notch. They have to now prove themselves. When I go out there and I've got a young AR who shows up and they're showing up 30 minutes before the game, they have the right uniform on. Another one, they got two watches on, right? I'm like, I can have more confidence as a referee before we even start because I'm seeing a young referee, a young man or woman who's into it. And those of you who worked with me, if any of you have, I'll say something like, tell me, William, how long you been doing this? William will tell me. I say, do you like it? Are you like into it? And sometimes I say, no, I'm not. My mom makes me do it. Okay. That's fine. So I said, no, I'm really into it. I saw one young man, it was a high school game, he was a young guy, and I asked him a year ago, I said, and he was refereeing with a guy who's like my age. I said, are you into it? He goes, I want to be an MLS referee. I said, that's awesome, all right? So showing up in the right uniform early, I learned early because back when I was youngin', and we had watches that had, you probably never seen one unless you've been to Smithsonian, they had hands on them. And I'm doing a game, this is before I had a stopwatch even. So we would look at the time, it's now 8:47, I think, well, the game is 40 minute half, so let's see, when it gets around to whatever, I have to do math in my head, that'll be halftime. And I'm doing a game, and the ball hits my hand. And the next time I look at my watch, the hands are like off the watch. So I'm going just until people started saying, "Hey, were we playing an hour?" "Oh, yeah, it's halftime." But you send signals. When you show up on time, in the right uniform, with your flag, with your two watches, you send a signal to the referee, and you send a signal to sophisticated observers like me that you are into it. And this is how this helps. This is how this helps. If I'm observing a game as a parent or when I was coaching, and I see a referee or an AR who's working hard, who's running, who is, if you're the AR, you are paying attention, you're staying with that second to last defender, you're moving like they move on TV, and something happens and you reach a decision that I don't agree with, I'm going to give you grace because you're working, you're there. If you're like the referee I saw last Monday night, the AR last Monday night in a high school game, who never, for the whole, what did they play, 80 minutes, was not in the right position. The AR never, ever, ever tried to get even with the second to last defender. He's something like walking here. Wasn't even close, right? Now, fortunately, in that game, that he made no match critical decision. But had he been involved in something close, he's going to get blasted, I think, with justification by the coaches because he wasn't even trying. So one thing you can do as a youngin, if you're going to go out to a DC United game, get your mom and dad, if you're going to go early. Go early. Go when the gates open. Watch when the referees come out, which I think is around 25 or 20 minutes before. They come out, they do a warm-up. Like Eric and I Mr. Heisman and I were talking the other day, like, we're old. He's not as old as I am, but we do warm-ups before the game. Like, I got to go and do the thing. So I'm watching, when I go to DC United game, I'm watching the referees when they come out. What are they doing? How do they act? How do they dress? Because even though I'm not an MLS referee, right, and you're not an MLS referee, watching how the pros act tells you how to act. And even if you've never done a game, you can fake it. And in young refereeing, faking it until you make it is important. It really, really is. Showing up, acting like you care, running, right? It doesn't matter if you have little experience, and it hardly matters if you're getting stuff wrong. Because Jocelyn, you were saying you were on the line, and now I've watched you, right? So I know that you were working hard. I know that you're paying attention. I know that you know what you're doing. And so now you can think to yourself, that lady is a freaking idiot who's yelling at me, okay? But if you're not in position, and you're not working hard, and someone's yelling at you, you probably deserve to get yelled at. All right. Next thing is a young referee, and again, we're still under the professional attitude stuff, you're bringing that to the game, is you go out there and you tell that center referee, my name is Ben, I've been doing this for 2 years, or I'm really new, or I haven't done too many games, whatever it is. And when that center referee tries to shortcut the pregame, and doesn't spend time with you, don't let that happen. And moms and dads, if you're watching your kids, your youngins go out to be an AR, and you see a center referee who's shortcutting the pregame, don't let that happen. In fact, I think mom and dad goes and says, "Hey, Mr. Highsmith, this is Billy, and this is his first season, okay?" So now Eric knows, all right? And if you're the AR, here's the question you ask the referee. How can I serve you best today? What do you want me to do for you? My instruction to ARs, part of it is, your job is to make me look really good, and my job is to make you look really good. And so what I need you to do is I need you to don't worry about offsides, don't worry about fouls. I first want you to show me that you are in the right position. I want you to chase down every ball. I want really good positioning on the second to last defender. All that other stuff will get figured out. Remember, I refereed for years and years and years. We didn't have ARs. I can tell offsides, all right? But and as the young'un out there, you demand that from the adult referee. How can I help you? And if they blow you off, then you tell your assigner later, look, I asked. The referee's shirking on his duty to do a proper pregame, and I want to work with guys and gals who will teach me more about the game. So that's, so now it's two things. So be a master of the laws of the game and bring a professional attitude to the game will take you lots of places. Any questions about that stuff?
Yeah. With the pregame, you know how you have to do the field inspection?
Yes.
Can you let the previous ref, can you let their inspection stand? Like if the center was the center at the prior game?
Yeah, so the question is you're showing up as an AR? Mm-hmm. And yeah, to me, and the question is the referee who you're working with presumably did an inspection before that. All right, I'm going to give you my opinion on this, is that this is the referee's responsibility, and that if the referee says to you, go check, make sure that goal is good. All right, if he doesn't, I think you're okay as the AR. If the ball goes through a side net hole, he's in big trouble, all right? As a referee, I liked, even on these turf fields where there's no imperfections in the field, you know, the nets are all $5,000 goals and stuff, you know, I like to show up early and do that inspection. But you should ask, do you want me to go and check that goal? All right? It actually looks pretty cool. The referees go out, and the two ARs go to check the goal. I mean, to guys like me who are sitting watching a game, like I'm watching like a U19 rec game, girls game, SFL or something, I'm like, that's awesome. We got three officials who are into it. All right? Is that helpful?
Yes.
All right, any questions about that? Okay. Yes, sir.
You have one question, Ben. You mentioned how you were talking about uniforms and the age of the uniform. Considering how often the design can change,
yeah.
Which you were saying that if it's 5 years old, you're not.
Here's the point I'm making, is every time they change a design, there's some grace period. I see guys, and again, it's not kiddos, I see older referees go out there and they're two designs behind, some of them. And all I'm saying is, they start down here with me. They may be great, they may be fabulous. They gotta work their way back up. When you show up in the right uniform, which is, again, it's relatively easy today because it's easy to go buy this stuff online at Springfield Soccer. So.
Well, it's still the right uniform, it's just the striping looks a little different.
Yeah. And when you're out there with a faded flag that is from the 70s and a faded shirt and gray shorts, as a soccer person, I'm drawing conclusions about you. I'm reading the book cover. They may be totally wrong conclusions, but at least I'm forming an impression. And so what I'm saying is, why leave that to chance? Let's go out there looking good.
Here.
All right, so now here's the last thing that I did, and it's the thing that the least number of people will do. But it's a cool life lesson, is very early on, because I figured I was into it. I loved refereeing. I worked lots and lots of games. Again, I told you about, you know, driving all over the place to do games. And I figured out that I could learn about the sport of refereeing, the science, the psychology of refereeing, by reading books. And so way back then, I started collecting all sorts of biographies and autobiographies written by and for referees. Jack Taylor, World Cup referee, Graham Pohl. So it's probably, does anybody here know why Graham Pohl is famous? You? No. Actually, I'm going to relate him to you in just a minute. Do you know why? Awesome. Watch this.
Hey, Ben, can I just interrupt?
Yes.
Just doing a sign up, just put your name, print your name, and if you've signed up. You know, we don't need email addresses unless you're new. You've never been here before, okay? So everybody must sign up on this sign up sheet, okay? It's going around. Thank you, Ben.
Yes. All right, so Graham Pohl, very famous, top referee from England, 2006 World Cup. He's refereeing, a quarterfinal game. And if he does well in the game and England doesn't make it to the World Cup final, he's the odds-on favorite to referee the World Cup final. And in this game, he ends up giving one player three yellow cards, same player. So he gives him a player one, he gives the player a first yellow card. Later, near the end of the game, a second yellow card, but he gets mixed up. And he's got some reasons, he's analyzed it now, but he doesn't send the player off. Now, mind you, we have two ARs and fourth official. Fourth official is American referee, Kevin's,
and a fifth
official, and they're all wired, and the whole team misses it. And at that level, when you make a mistake like that, your next ticket is to the boat to go home, all right? The point I would make with you, and this is why this book is so cool, is that Graham Pohl later, he wrote this book where he looked at 10 of the worst errors made by referees in the history of the World Cup and a whole bunch of other incidents, mainly from English League, and he analyzed what went wrong and how the mistake could have been prevented. And I drew, as I was a young referee, making my mistakes, having nightmares, having games that were just disastrous, I drew from books like this the conclusion that it happens to everybody. And nothing I've ever done in a game is as bad as on TV in a World Cup game where your next match is because potentially the World Cup final and you book the guy three times. He did give him a red card in the third one. So when you did that, that high school game recently, if I could just mention that, you weren't the first. You won't be the last. All right?
I didn't show three yellow cards. I just
I know.
Show, I hadn't paid attention, and I showed his second yellow card, and I didn't show the red card.
Yes.
I make mistakes.
So, yeah, of course you make mistakes. We're involved in a game where we're running up and down a big field, we're making judgments, we're making some people unhappy, and what I'm trying to do is to give you that inner strength to say to yourself, it's okay. It's not the end of the world. I don't care, and I've had those games. Everybody's mad at me. The season or last season, some coach said something like, well, okay, you're mad, he's mad, we're all good. It happens to the best. Even today, if you follow like the referee blogs and stuff, if you read anything about the MLS, like the top topic in the MLS this year is how, quote, bad the refereeing is, how inconsistent the refereeing is. So it happens everywhere. Right? You are awesome for putting yourself out there, subjecting yourselves to abuse by idiot adults, coaches, and parents. And what I'm trying to do is to empower you to get through it. Because once you do, as a young person, like the amount of money you can make doing this is virtually unlimited. I mean, it's limited only by the amount of hours you're willing to go out and to work. What's the taxes? Hey, look, here's my view on taxes. The more taxes I have to pay just means I made more money. So that's cool. I can't change the taxing, but I can go out and referee another game. All right, so, what's your name again?
Andrew.
And you have not refereed a game in the middle, right?
No.
Right? Do you want to?
Yes.
You see yourself doing that?
Yes.
Do you have a whistle?
No.
You don't have a whistle. All right.
My dad does.
Okay, but we'll come back. We'll come there. Who else has not done a game? Has not done a game in the middle. Anyone else? So.
What, in the last year? Or?
No, ever. Ever. So, like, what are we waiting for? Okay? All right, so I see 1, 2, 3, 4 of the hands I see, all right? I'm going to give you the tip. Here's a tip to refereeing your first game in the middle. It's an awesome, awesome tip. Is get a great whistle, practice. Not in your bedroom, go out to a field and practice blowing the whistle hard. Because what the thing that young referees, they go out there and like, I'm in charge of a game and I'm just a young person, and so I have to blow my whistle lightly. Which then tells everyone, I'm a young referee just starting. If you will go and practice with a good whistle, and the very first time you go out there, you blow that whistle with authority, you are now 10 steps farther down the line, and one of the, there's one. So if you promise me The Fox 40 whistle is one of the best whistles in the world. It's one of the loudest whistles. And who are, I had one more? Yes. So, but here's the promise you have to make, okay? Doesn't have to be tomorrow, doesn't have to be next weekend. But sometime this spring or this fall, get a game. Go out and do it. You can do it. You can be awesome. And that whistle will help you be awesome. All right? Okay. Yes?
Ben, I got one comment to make. I was doing an NCSL game 2 years ago. And talk about a nightmare. My whistle failed.
Yes?
And I'm out on the field. And we're 3/4 of the way through the game. And of course, I never carry an extra whistle in my pocket.
And?
I've got one in my car.
Yeah, so, all right, so that's, so what do we learn?
I always have a second one in my bag.
Yes, what do we learn from that experience? So, do you have one of these Velkeen whistles? No. So it's like a $50 whistle. It's a whistle they use at the World Cup. I'm not a World Cup referee, but mentally, I want to be. Every single game I go out there, I want to be the best referee on that field for them that day. And you always have two, and I carry 4 cards, and I know some referees carry 6 cards. And I've seen referees go out there, and they blow their whistle real loud, and they're reaching in this pocket, and this pocket, and this, and they don't have their cards. All right, so it's just about 8 o'clock, and I really appreciate you guys listening to this. I've got a couple other things for you, a gift. Anybody wants to stick around, I'm happy to answer questions. And I got to tell you the resource. All right, so number one. So I'm obviously, I hope you see this, passionate, not only about refereeing, but helping youngins become referees. We are launching tonight a website called icanref.com. Icanref.com, that's going to be a resource. And so we're going to have links to great videos, links to some Facebook sites, you got to check with your parents about that, where referees of all ages, sizes, experiences, get together to discuss online things. I watch, and I probably watch way too many incident videos a week. So icanref.com. So we have got a couple things for everybody who would like. Number one is, if you didn't get one before, so we have these very cool holders go in the back of your cell phone. It says Ben Glass Law, that's my law firm. We have got my world famous now parent yellow cards, right? Which are like, have the link to iCanRef, and at iCanRef.com there's a video that says, I'm glad you're here, parent, loudmouth parent, you ought to come join us, okay? And here's what you do to join us. So we've got as many of these if you like for each one of you. If you also, we made up these cool, I think they're cool, tags for your bags, right? You can write your name on it. Has my name on the back, so you remember me. But referee tags, so these are up here for anybody who would like it. And we also have the Ben Glass magazine. Now, guy's got a huge ego. But let me tell you what's in here. So a couple things I didn't get to. So number one, we've got an article for your parents about refereeing. Number two, we've got an article about, it's called Play Left Fullback. And it's a great life lesson on showing up and being different and making yourself noticed. I guarantee you'll be valuable. And I got an article in here about a 91-year-old guy who is making and breaking world records in running, and he's awesome and inspiring. So we've got that for everybody, and I think that's it. So thank you for coming. If you have questions, you're happy to stay, and I'll stay as long as you want.
Yeah,
if you need to go, you can go, and Amy's got some directions.
Yeah, so nobody leave yet. Okay, yeah,